So welcome to Coffee Can Investing. We are in the A today with Navneet Munot, the CIO of SBI Mutual Funds, one of the largest mutual funds in the country. Welcome to the program, Navneet.
Thank you. My pleasure.
So let's begin at the very start. Urban legend has it that you started investing when you were 11 or 12 years old. Now, most of us are trying to figure out our football and cricket careers at that age. How come you were investing from such an early age?
The downside of that is I'm not good at any sport, physical sport. So I grew up in a small town in Rajasthan, a place called Byawar. It's in Ajmer district in Rajasthan. And so the family was into small business, some agency businesses. And in those days, in early 80s, we booked a scooter, LML Vespa, which was like a new product, a very interesting product. And in the market, there was a huge premium for that product. I mean, if you get the allotment, this was like a lottery when you're booking the scooter. And then we thought that, okay, the company's product is so good and it'll make so much of money, and ended up investing in the stocks. And then I saw in the newspaper the price was like 60 or 70. And I was like, what a great way of making money. You can multiply your money 6 or 7 times. But in a small time, those days, there was no TV, no internet. We used to listen to BBC every day. That was like a reach.
On the radio, BBC World Service.
On the BBC World Service radio. And it had huge interest in like global macro out of like pure academic interest. There was no global business there. And there used to be this newspaper called Vyapar. It's a Gujarati newspaper, a bi-weekly, where I used to read about Manu Manik, Nimesh Shah, Alkesh.
You know how to read Gujarati as well?
Yeah, because of that reason, because we used to get that Gujarati newspaper there. And then you read about like all markets. My father used to say, har price kuch kehta hai. Every price says something. So whether we are dealing, not dealing, but I think you should keep looking at various prices and why different markets are moving. So I think that kept the interest on. I used to write a daily diary about what happened in market. I think in like 80s, early 80s when I started, and I still remember several of those companies. Several of them don't exist now.
This is when India is winning the World Cup in 83, Asian Games.
84, yeah, Indira Gandhi got shot dead. 84, Rajiv Gandhi, 85. And 85 was the first big bull market in India, and I have those memories etched in me, what really happened.
Amazing. So from, I suppose, that sort of background led naturally to chartered accountancy. And then I suppose came the big sort of formative stage of your career, Aditya Birla Group. How did you end up joining the behemoth that is Aditya Birla even today?
So pure luck, I got a rank in CA. So actually in a small town in Rajasthan, I mean, you have no other option. Unless you want to move out of the city, you can do a CA from there. So I did CA, and luck had it that I got a rank, which was a 50th rank.
50th All India?
50th All India. So they only give merit to 50th. 50 people, and I was 50th. It's just that pure luck. Because of that, you get a lot of letters from, interview letters from companies. Aditya Birla was the least paying, but I thought that in financial services, Birla Group wanted to be a large player in the financial services, and I chose that. And then,
which year are we talking about here?
I think it was 93, 94, yeah.
So India has liberalized, Harshad Mehta.
Exactly, yeah.
Is in full flight.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, amazing. So from what I know, you spent a good 14 years in Aditya Birla Group in various roles. Just talk us through that, in particular, what we're very keen to understand is the influence that had on your subsequent development as a fund manager.
So, you know, this book Outliers by Malcolm Gladwell. So all of us were very lucky. We were at the right time at the right place. So in early 90s, markets were opening up. I started as a market maker in an exchange called OTC exchange. It doesn't exist today, but that was the first electronic exchange in India to trade in several small companies. And then NSE came, DMAT, there were various new markets, derivatives and all of that. And I was like part of the financial services group, one of the early employees. And it had like, from a purely learning perspective, worked in bond market, in equity. 97, 98 was very interesting. I was part of 2-member foreign exchange advisory cell. Used to write a daily on foreign exchange market and advise the
entire Birla Group.
Yeah, and there was a time of that Asian and the Asian crisis, Russian crisis, LTCM. I mean, that was a great learning. And all these years, I was quite involved with the insurance company. When the insurance company got set up, I was there on their investment committee, drafted the investment policy for them. And of course, large number of years in the AMC, also worked on the sales side. So I think across financial services, it was a great opportunity to learn a lot of things. Saw a lot of cycles during that time. So I saw the 10-year bond yield falling from 14% to 5% during that time period. And I remember 2000 to 2000. 2003, when my gilt fund delivered 20% per annum almost, when equities were negative. So the big tech boom and bust, where stocks could go up 100 times and they could fall 99% in a few days' time. So a big boom and bust in NBFCs, where most of our competitors who were pretty large, I was initially in the Birla Group NBFC, Birla Global Finance Limited, and then they didn't exist. Saw a huge boom and bust in several other industries during 90s, and there was a big boom in 94 with the GDR money and all, both in the equity and credit side, and several of those companies don't exist. So I think it was a phenomenal learning experience over the years.
Tell me something, one of the most interesting facets of your career is your experience at Birla as a debt fund manager, and you know, you ran a bond fund there successfully. You also ran a hybrid fund there. Given that most of the CIOs have come to this program have been from equity backgrounds, you have an exceptional chance here to understand from you how a debt fund manager views investment. So can you give us a sense as to what is the difference between how a debt fund manager views the world and how an equity fund manager would view the world?
So the debt guys look at a couple of things from a top-down perspective. You have to take a duration call, you have to take a sector call, which is like between government bonds and corporate, high grade or high yield within that with sectors. Mm-hmm. And you have to take a call on the yield curve, which are like big top-down calls that you need to take. Mm-hmm. And then security selection is very much bottom-up. Credit right. is very much bottom-up. And right. then, of right. course, we apply a lot more quantitative right. you know, analysis relative to equity, and it's slightly different than the equity. Otherwise, a pure credit is very, very similar to the equities. I mean, you are looking at the cash flows, you are looking at the business. On a lighter note, I keep saying that debt guys always look at what can go wrong, equity yeah. guys look at what can go right. Right. And I think they make a good combination when they work together. Right. Also, debt in India is a lot more, I would say, relative to equity, transactional in nature. You have to worry a lot about liquidity. The debt fund managers spend a lot of time in the dealing room because you're fighting for every basis point. You have to look at multiple sources of alpha. You look at several different kinds of arbitrage within the market to generate alpha. So it's slightly different. There's a lot of structuring which is involved. Again, to repeat the same point, that debt is a lot more about numbers. I think equity is a lot more about narrative. That's another difference between the equity and the debt guys. Also, I think the debt guys don't get much invited in coffee can investing.
Right. So which is why we're delighted to
also in terms of benchmarking. So in benchmark, when you look, people look at the equity returns, they look at what the benchmark is given. But particularly in India, when you look at the fixed income returns, I mean, people still have that absolute returns or what you have delivered relative to your peers.
Right, right. So in a way, the debt mindset and the equity mindset, you could argue, are complementary.
Oh, absolutely, no doubt. In fact, if you look at globally, I mean, a Paul Singer, Howard Marks, I mean, a Seth Klarman, I can just go on, Ray Dalio, they are what? I mean, they are investors. It's all about discounting cash flows and then the certainty and the probability of it. And I think it's across structures. And I think as markets evolve in India, you have the REITs. What is a REIT? I mean, is it equity? Is it bond? Or a combination of both? I think we are going to have more and more. I think the people who have the skill set in both, I think they will do well.
Fantastic. Now, talk us about that transition to Morgan Stanley. How did that opportunity come about? And you know, what did you learn in those years?
So interestingly, I mean, though I was a CIO and probably could have ended up with more management responsibility, I had this huge dream of becoming a global macro hedge fund manager, a global macro fund manager, and Aran and some of my other friends who were there in Morgan Stanley, they convinced me that if you want to be a global fund manager, then this is a platform.
Right.
And I joined there. But maybe after some time, I thought that probably the another platform like SBI was better.
Right.
But so deep in me somewhere, because I used to be a big fan of people like George Soros, I used to follow Bill Gross, and I thought that maybe you need a platform where you can actually manage money from a global perspective.
So you certainly got a platform, and more you built more than a platform over the last 10 years. As we sort of get into the SBI narrative, there's various facets of your SBI career which I think are very, very interesting. But let's start with the first piece of your career which I find very interesting, which is your ability to understand credit cycles, right? So, you know, if you look at the world outside India, someone like Howard Marks has written extensively about how to understand credit cycles. Where are we in a credit cycle today? Are we at the top? Are we at the bottom? And is loan growth going to take off? Is it going to die down? How do you read credit cycles? How, what metrics, what markers, indicators do you use to understand where are we in a credit cycle?
So this guy, Paul McKinney, that time he was in PIMCO, he made this term very famous, Minsky moment, that led me to read Hyman Minsky, the famous economist, who said that the period of stability or prosperity leads to instability or the distress in market. And there are five stages of these cycles. So you start with a displacement, your boom, euphoria, profit taking, and panic. And markets go through that stage. It starts with a period where there is an innovation, or there is like this time it's different. For example, I mean, let's say the subprime market in US. And then it leads to more and more easier lending to the sector. Over a period of time, it becomes euphoric, where the LTV, the loan to value ratio, goes down, the lending standards go down substantially, underwriting standards go down, money is easily available, it becomes a euphoric. At some point in time, debt is not enough to pay, I mean, the cash flows are not enough to pay the debt, and then it leads to a little bit of profit booking, asset sell, and then finally, it leads to a situation like panic. And I don't call it a greed and fear cycle, I call it a fear and fear cycle, where it's a fear of losing the deal, and then you move to a fear of losing money. Right. So at one extreme, you don't want to lose the deal at any price, another extreme where you don't want to do the deal at any price.
Right. Very interesting.
So it's like markets move from one extreme to another extreme, and we have seen those cycles over the years.
Right. So let me come to the second facet of your SBI career, which I find very interesting. Most successful fund managers, not just in India, I think the world over, most successful fund managers are characterized by, you know, insecurity. You know, you could argue the insecurity itself makes them very successful. They work very hard, driven by insecurity. And yet you're a CIO in a mega fund house who doesn't run a fund. How have you managed to reconcile these two sort of elements of success in fund management?
You're touching a sensitive nerve. So of course, I mean, I manage a team. I work on culture, I work on governance, I work on processes, I work on philosophy, I work on client relationships, so on and so forth, and do everything other than managing the money directly. And I was very passionate. I told you the reason I joined Morgan Stanley from Birla, because I wanted to just manage the money over a longer period. Having said that, you know, the interesting aspect is that we are a very analyst-driven fund house. Each one of us are an analyst. The 50-people team at SBI, we are all an analyst first, and a fund manager, a head of equity, CIO later. And we believe that, I mean, that's the best part of our job, and I'm one of those analysts, work with extremely talented people. And the most enjoyable time in office is when you really sit as an analyst with the other analysts, the other 50 analysts in our company. So not managing a fund with a name attached to it, I think that's not too big a deal. But being part of that analyst team is a great joy.
It takes a lot of character to do that. It also takes a lot of character to do what your fund house have seen do repeatedly over the last few years. Most fund houses in India are reluctant to pick fights with promoters, with powerful companies. I suppose they worry about, you know, business being at jeopardy if they were to take on corporate governance issues with any major promoter. Yet SBIMF, and correct me if I'm wrong in this regard, I remember you guys took a stance on the way Suzuki was treating Maruti minority shareholders. I remember you taking a stance on the Satya Mehta's deal all the way back 10, 11 years ago, and recently on Vedanta and the Niyamgiri episode in Odisha. Where does this spine come from in a industry which is not known in India for showing spine, especially on corporate governance issues? Where did SBIMF find this streak of resistance to abuses by promoters of minority shareholders?
So first of all, I wouldn't use the word fight, by the way. Maybe in case of Satyam, it was kind of a fight, but otherwise I would use the word constructive engagement. Okay. And I strongly believe that as a minority shareholder, we should have this continuous constructive engagement with the companies to ensure that our interests are completely aligned. Right. Historically, mutual funds or institutional investors voted with their feet. They were not as large. If you didn't like a company, if you didn't like what management was doing, you just get out of the stock or you don't look at that stock. But as you become larger and larger, that becomes very, very tough. We also manage a lot of passive money, where if a stock is there in the index, then you have to buy the stock. And I realized that over a period of time, it's better to engage proactively. The regulatory environment has also helped. I think the rights that minority shareholders enjoy today was not the case several years back. And I think the companies have also realized that by engaging constructively, by engaging proactively, it's helping in better value creation or better premium that the market gives for better governance. So I think it's been a good journey over the last few years, but I'm sure we have a long way to go.
Right. So that brings us to the next topic, ESG. So we've got to a juncture in India where there are several ESG funds being launched. You could argue after large cap and small cap investing, it's almost the most popular theme going at the moment. There are ESG metrics and indices which have been launched by the global index providers. And yet at SBI, if my memory serves me right, you launched your ESG fund several years ago, 3-4 years ago. What led you to spot the potential of this theme, well before the world, rest of the world woke up to it?
So we started on ESG integration into our investment process several years ago, almost I remember 5-7 years ago. Though we launched a product on the PMS platform around 3-3.5 years ago. This is not only ESG, but a very strict socially responsible investing. Then we converted one of our flagship large cap fund into an ESG focused fund last year. It's completing a year and it's done well. I think idea was that companies that are focused on ESG, which are good, I mean, their environmental footprint, social impact, better governance, would end up generating better value over a longer period of time. Mm. It's part of a value system and a belief that over a longer period, this is important. Also from a risk management perspective, that this could be a source of alpha if you are investing in companies that score higher on ESG front, but also if you don't do that, then there could be several mishaps. And if you look at the news flow over the last few years, companies that ignored the environmental factors, companies that ignored social factors, companies that didn't score high on governance factors, how markets have treated them. It's in infancy in India. Globally, as you rightly said, I mean, investors are asking for ESG focused fund. In India, it's other way around, where as manager, we are going and creating the awareness within the companies, within, I mean, at various forums, including our investors, that why ESG is important.
Right. So one of the things I've seen with my clients outside India is that there's far more desire on the part of global institutional investors to see ESG investing. That hasn't, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm not yet aware that Indian investors are that obsessed.
It was other way around. So when we launched this, I mean, when we put this large cap ESG focused fund last year, we actually lost money in first few months.
Right.
Because a lot of investors thought that it would come at the cost of your returns.
Right, yes.
But we have a very strong belief that over a longer period, this will be a source of alpha. Also keep thinking that the same point I made earlier, as we become larger and larger as an asset manager, we have a huge stake in the economy. And unless the growth is sustainable, unless the growth is equitable, even it will impact the overall beta, the overall market return. So it's our responsibility that we do the right things through our investments, which increases the economic return, which increases the overall corporate profitability, which is sustainable over a longer period of time.
So let's come to another element of sustainability, which is our profession, the investment profession. Both of us are CFA charter holders. You're the leader of the CFA community in India. You're also a chartered accountant. Most youngsters I tend to see in India tend to be very confused as to what exactly they should study. Should they be a CA, MBA, CFA? What would your advice be to an aspiring investor, someone who wants to be like you 10, 15 years out? What should he or she focus on in her late teens, early 20s?
CFA surely helps simply because of the good body of knowledge which you do over the three levels. Also, I think tremendous focus on ethics, which is an aspect which is quite ignored several times. Also, I think it's a part of like lifelong learning and the networking opportunity that you get with like-minded people over a long period. So CFA surely helps. I think any background in accounting or if you understand the financial statements, that surely makes you a better investor. Otherwise, I think investing is a lot more about common sense than I think pursuing those degrees. I think several of those things which are taught in particular courses can also be learned on your own today. I mean, there are so many sources, including the coffee can investing series that you do.
Right. So you mentioned one very interesting book, Hyman Minsky and the and Cycles. Any other reads that have had a big influence on your career? Any specific thing, by Soros or Singer?
So Soros, I used to be a big fan. In fact, I used to have a screensaver of George Soros. I read all his books. I remember like 93, The Man Who Broke the Bank of England. I think, of course, everybody talks about the Benjamin Graham and Phil Fisher. Yeah. I mean, those are the textbooks you have to read. Yeah. I like all about financial history. So you read Peter Bernstein, Charles Kindleberger, you read people like them, the Neil Ferguson, The Ascent of Money. I think it's very important to know the long-term history of markets, money, finance. It helps, I mean, if you read some of the books on behavioral aspects of it. So Nassim Taleb's Fooled by Randomness, I think, is a compulsory thing to read. Thinking Fast, Thinking Slow. From an equity perspective, I think it's important to read people like Michael Porcher. I think the competitive advantage is the most important thing you need to understand. Creative Destruction, Schumpeter, that's very important. And I generally like classics. You read Adam Smith, you read Keynes, you read people like Milton Friedman, and of course, going back to philosophy. I think more than these finance, I think it's the appreciation of the role that history, philosophy, evolutionary biology, some of those, psychology, they are very, very important in investing.
That's an amazing reading list. So that's an appropriate juncture to turn to our audience here. We've got several people here who've come a long way. So open to you guys, feel free to fire questions at Navneet Munot.
What are the ethical aspects that you personally follow in terms of being a portfolio manager?
Well, that's an interesting question. In fact, there's a reason we appreciate the CFA course, simply because there is so much of emphasis. 15% of exam is on ethics, and in our industry, where the line between what is right and what is not right is very, very thin in financial services, and it's very important that people appreciate the importance of the ethical behavior. We manage somebody else's money, and I think as long as we remember that this is a very noble job, we are dealing with somebody else's money, and also ensure that each one of our action must not lead to something which leads to people's, you know, the people's trust in capital markets get shaken, then it can have a huge negative impact on our lives or on the society as a whole. There were so many mishaps in the 90s in India, and that's why somewhere the trust got broken. So I think all of us in financial services have this huge responsibility on our shoulders to ensure that our behavior is very ethical and we win the trust of society at large.
Navneet, let's say before you really started with ESG investing, suppose you had an investable universe of, let's say, 500 companies. And after you applied ESG screen, how many of those 500 companies really, you know, passed that test? So what is the kind of ESG framework that the listed, specifically in the listed space, that the companies follow?
So particularly in the ESG focus fund, there is a negative list of certain sectors which cannot be invested, which may be invested in some of the other funds, and then we look at an ESG score, which is based on, as I said earlier, the environmental footprint, the social impact, and the governance parameters. And below a certain score, we don't invest in those companies. So roughly in our ESG fund, in our universe, there would be around, I don't remember the number, but I think the number that you said, maybe I think 30-40% companies won't meet that the high water mark to come into the ESG fund.
And you see that the trend is definitely shifting towards the companies, because one of the largest asset managers like you and SBI, if you are not choosing to invest in those companies, at least in some specific funds that follow ESG guideline, then are the companies making the conscious effort to be ESG compliant?
So it's a journey. So I think it's not about, so companies are also aware, right? And there is going to be more and more regulatory nudge. There is going to be more nudge from the society. There's going to be nudge from the investors like us. And all of that will ensure that companies move in the desired direction, in the right direction. That if, let's say, if your carbon emissions are very high, of course, there would be pressure from all sides to find ways how do you reduce your carbon emissions.
Good afternoon, Navneet. Two questions, actually. The first question is, for the investor, what would your advice be? Because at the end of the day, while India is booming and markets are growing rapidly, and equity is becoming a more and more popular investment opportunity. Nevertheless, it is fairly common knowledge that most people at a retail level don't make money when they invest in equity for reasons which one need not go into here. How do you advise investors to, you know, look at equity going forward? Because at the end of the day, people get swayed by so many things. And the second question to that is, at the end of the day, with the industry growing so rapidly, what changes do you foresee as far as the intermediary community is, whether you call them investment advisors, whether you call them distributors, because they play a very important role. And I think the role of advice, the cost of advice, how does one tackle that challenge? Because at the end of the day, a customer doesn't necessarily want to pay for advice, you know, if one understands that. So these are the two questions.
So on the common people, how should they approach investing? I think, as someone rightly said, that investing is less about gathering more information or more intelligence or more analysis, a lot more about common sense. And I think just having the faith over a longer period that power of compounding works in your favor if you are in the right asset class and then remain disciplined on that path, it's a lot more about the EQ emotional quotient than the intelligence quotient. On the second question on how the advisor's role will evolve, so I think over a period of time we'll move more and more from a product selling to a more solution selling. It's already happening in India. I meet a large number of advisors, how they have evolved over the last 10, 20, 30 years. It's a lot different today. It's a clients first, sales later, or a process first, outcome later, more about the relationship, more about understanding their needs, understanding their goals, understanding their risk appetite, doing the handholding during different market cycles. And I think that's where the advisory profession is moving, which is a very healthy sign.
Thank you very much, Navneet. That was a very stimulating session of Coffee Can Investing. We're glad that you could attend the session and give us your thoughts. Thank you. And that's it from us. That's it from Coffee Can Investing for the day.